So I'm here with Caroline Lucas, parliamentary candidate for the Green Party for the Brighton Pavillion ward.
That's right.
Constituency. So welcome to our latest news.
Thank you.
So how's the campaign going? Because it's going to be interesting in your seat. Got Lib Dems stepping down, but we've still got Labour and Conservative candidates. So how's it going so far for you?
I think it's going incredibly well. I mean, we're getting a great response on the doorstep. I'm really proud that since I was first elected for the Brighton Pavillion constituency in 2010, my majority grew in 2015, 2017. I hope it might again. As you say, the Lib Dems have stood down and I'm grateful to them for doing that. That was part of a so-called Unite to Remain alliance in a number of seats. Having said that, the last time the Lib Dems stood in Brighton Pavillion, it was a very small number that they got and they don't have any local councillors. But nonetheless, it's a big thing to stand aside. So I want to thank Paul Chandler for doing that.
Yeah, what are the big issues over there in a Brighton Pavillion ward? Because it's a big old constituency. You've got the two universities there, but you've got like Patcham as well. So it's...
You mentioned the universities. I mean, they are deeply concerned about Brexit. And you know, Boris Johnson kind of sold this election as the Brexit election. I voted against having the general election. I was one of the 20 MPs who voted against it because I don't think a general election is going to resolve Brexit. I want to see a people's vote. I want it to go back to the people. And I think that is a majority view, certainly on the doorsteps that I speak to when I go around the constituency. So people are deeply worried about Brexit. It's going to have big implications economically here for the city. We depend so much on freedom of movement for our leisure services in the city. We depend on it for the universities, for many of our businesses. That is a very big issue, and I'm proud to have been one of the co-founders of the People's Vote campaign. And the Green Party position, contrary to the Labour Party, is not only that we want there to be a people's vote, but we are saying loudly, proudly, clearly now that we will be campaigning to remain inside the EU. So Brexit is a big issue, climate is a big issue. Actually, you mentioned Patcham, and flooding is always a big issue in Patcham.
I
keep watching these awful images of what we're seeing up in South Yorkshire and just really hoping that we don't get those floods down here. And I keep having conversations with the water authorities and others about how do we make sure that Patcham doesn't flood again, because it absolutely turns people's lives upside down.
There's a river running under Old London Road, so that's the main thing. And you're right, there's a lot of areas around Patcham which they're below sea level, so the flooding is an issue there. And we're seeing that in our news, you know, bulletins every day now, aren't we, that climate change is impacting everyday
life. Yeah, I think we've really got to the point now where people understand that climate change isn't just some distant threat that might affect other countries. It affects all of us right now. And I would want this election to be the climate election, in the sense that the climate scientists are telling us literally that the next Parliament, the next 5 and 10 years, are going to be critical in terms of whether or not we take urgent enough action to mean we get off this collision course we're currently on with climate catastrophe. And the Green Party has been banging on about the importance of taking action on climate change for years. We have a target of reaching net zero by 2030. We think the government's idea of getting to net zero emissions by 2050, another 30 years away, simply isn't right. It's like saying that there's an emergency and calling 999 and saying, can I have a fire engine in 30 years' time? I mean, that makes no sense at all. The emergency is now. So we want to see action on that climate emergency, and we want to see what we're calling a Green New Deal. I was part of the original group back in 2007 that came up with this idea of a Green New Deal, which is basically a massive transformation of our society and our infrastructure so that we make ourselves resilient to climate shocks in the future, but we also massively reduce our fossil fuel emissions and switch to renewable energy.
Yeah, I think you're in a strong position because the environment is a big campaigning issue now. It wasn't 10 years ago, I don't think, but now it is. It's up there, isn't it?
Even just a few years ago, I mean, you're right, I was walking around London with a great big green question mark because we were doing a kind of a stunt for the media saying the question mark was, where is the environment in this election?
Yeah.
This time around, just 2 years later, there's such a difference. And I pay tribute to, you know, the young climate strikers, and they've been really active here in Brighton as well. You know, the school strikers who've taken time off school to put this on the agenda. Yeah. Extinction Rebellion, I think, have done an amazing job. And again, there's a very strong XR group here in Brighton.
They've been on latest news quite a few times.
Well, good for them and good for you for having them, because I think they really have put the climate at the top of the agenda.
Yeah. So what are the other issues? I mean, commuting, we were talking about that off stage. I remember the train service is a lot better at Preston Park Station, isn't it?
I mean, that's
it needs
been
to
a...
be, because it takes pressure off of the main station.
I mean, it was unbelievable to see what GTR, the rail company, was planning to do to Preston Park Station. It was like they'd never been there and never realised it was such a busy, important station in our city. And so I have spent an awful lot of the last 18 months fighting with GTR to make sure they reinstate some of those rail services from Preston Park. And I'm glad to say that they are now reinstating some of those. And that was a really, really big issue locally. I would say the thing that actually fills my mailbag more than anything else, though, is the housing crisis in the city. And you only have to get off the train and start walking down towards the clock tower for just to see so much homelessness. And, you know, our city, I think, is particularly hard hit in the sense that the prices of accommodation here, as you know, is massive. The median cost of a house, if you were to try to buy one in Brighton and Hove, is, I think, 12 and a half times the average salary. I mean, this is just impossible. Rent is hugely high in the city, and I want to see rent controls. I'm very upfront about saying that I think the rents are too high in our city and they need to start coming down. So I want to continue to put as much pressure as I can on government, both to tackle the housing crisis head on with, you know, building far more council homes and social housing, ending the right to buy. I don't understand why we're transferring so much of our social housing stock, which is a public asset, into private hands. That makes no sense. But at the same time, to say that the last 10 years of Tory austerity, as you will know, have completely decimated so many of the services in our city, the services that were helping people with mental health problems or substance abuse problems. And all of that actually does tie in then to the housing crisis, because you have people who are more desperate, they can't get the support they need, and then they quite often lose their homes as well.
Yeah. So do you think, would you support rent controls, or is that part of the Green policy?
Completely. Yeah. We want to see rent controls. And by that, we mean not just simply that you stop rents rising higher than inflation. I want to see a living rent commission whereby you start looking at how you could bring rent down over time. You can't do it overnight. Obviously, I understand that landlords would potentially have a problem with that. But over time, at the very least, we need to stop them rising higher than inflation and then very quickly start coming down.
Yeah. We've had renters, Acorn Renters Union,
they do a brilliant job on
quite a lot in latest news as well. So
you
support their action?
Completely support their action. Yeah. I mean, I think they do such an important job, and they give such support to people who can often feel really desperate if they're, you know, they could be facing eviction, and that's wrong. And Acorn Renters does a great job. And it reminds me too that another campaign I've been running is to try to stop landlords and letting agents from discriminating from people because they're on benefits. It feels extraordinary to me that you can legally discriminate against someone because they are on benefits. And an advert, exactly. And a lot of people who depend on top-up benefits are actually in work. This is not some, you know, some kind of stereotype of people who don't want to work. These are people often working two or three jobs already and still can't make ends meet. And so they need some support, and yet then they get this absolute discrimination in the housing market, and that's just wrong.
Yeah. Do you know when your manifesto is going to be coming out? Do we know a launch date for that?
Do we know the launch date from that? It's sometime next week, but I don't know what the date is.
Yeah, OK. And with climate change, do you think Greta Thunberg, she's made quite a big difference, hasn't she, putting the environment on the agenda in the UK? So obviously you're supportive of all the work that she's doing?
I think she's doing an extraordinary job. And I think if you ever doubt that one person can change the world, then just look at what she's done, because her campaign started as a single young girl, aged, I think, then 15, sitting outside the Swedish Parliament with one placard talking about climate change. And she sat there in a solitary way for many weeks before this then got taken up nationally in Sweden and then globally. And now those climate strikes are happening in over 100 countries around the world. I mean, you can only feel, you know, incredible admiration for what she's done. But she doesn't want admiration. What she wants is action. And I was pleased to be able to, when she was last in the UK, I was able to arrange for her to meet the leaders of the other parties. Actually, the Conservatives didn't show up, but the other parties did. And to talk about how we can liaise with her, with the other UK climate strikers, to make sure that we actually do see action.
Just before we go, you've got more green councillors, haven't you, in your constituency as well? With Dean Ward, I think they're all green now.
They're all green now.
That's going to help, is it not, in the campaign?
It really is. I think there used to be a case where there was a difference in terms of green support with the four sort of more inner city wards and then the outer wards like Patcham and with Dean and so forth. And now that's really changing. And I'm so proud that I think the reason that it's changing is that when people see green councillors elected, they see them working really, really hard on their behalf. And that's why they want more to be elected too.
OK, we'll leave it there for now, Karen.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in, and hopefully we'll see you again on latest news soon.
Thanks so much.
Cheers. Thanks.